Good morning. Really good to see everyone here this morning. It's always a joy and a privilege to worship with everyone here. And so would you stand with me? Let us stand and worship and sing praise to our Lord, our God. Jesus, He is the King, and He's the object of our praise this morning. So here we go. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Good, all your ways are sure, and I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life, and I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. Freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow.
God dependent on any mortal man. You are are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plans. They're just the way it is. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything that we can give by your plans. That's just the way it is. You are God alone, for before time began, you were on your throne. You are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, God alone. You're the only God whose power none can contend. You're the only God whose name and praise will never end. You're the only God who's worthy of everything we can give. You are God, that's just the way. Good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. You are God alone. You are God alone. For before time began, you were on your throne. You are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on God alone. You're unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable. That's what you are. You're unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable. That's what you are. You're unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable, unshakable, unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone, from before time began. God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. You are God alone. From before time began, you were on your throne. You are God alone. Right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone.
Let's come to the Lord. Worship him, his great name, Jesus, the name above all name. Lost a saved, find their way.
the sound of your great name. All come down, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to flee at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God, Emmanuel. You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. All the weak find their strength at the sound of your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound of your great name. The fatherless, they find their rest at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God and man. You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Your great name. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, defender. The name of Jesus, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is it. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God, Amen. You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Sing that again. Jesus is worthy of it. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God, Amen. You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Your great name.
Father, we come before you this morning. Our heart's longing is to be in your presence. We thank you for just your love for us. We thank you for all the great things that you have done on the cross already for us. What are our responses? Father, I just pray that this morning the Holy Spirit convict our heart as you speak mightily through Pastor Bond. That truth, that urgency, that the gospel needs to be heard to the end of the earth. We thank you for this morning. I pray that you'll be pleased with our service this morning. Pray all this in the great name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. So grateful to have our speaker with us the last 2 days delivering three sermons, which is so powerful. I really enjoy his sermon. I also like his name. The name is Bond. Pastor Bond. It's referred as Pastor Bond, but his last name is Gaona. And he's married to Heather, his wife for 23 years. Lovely daughter, Brianna, school age. We're so blessed to have him. Pastor Bond is not strange to some of you. You have joined him for a mission trip before, and he actually recognized some of you and say hi to you. He's been a missionary to India, Nepal, China, and magic touch, just a little guitar. Okay, and North Uganda, reaching out to Muslims in that area. He's now joining a missionary group called SGWM, Saving Grace World Missions. And if you need more information, it's at the back. You're welcome to get more information. So he'll be in the future, again, reaching out to Nepal, India, and in Africa, those areas. Pastor Bond is really passionate about providing trainings, and most of all, his passion is to preach Jesus and Him crucified. We heard that from last 2 days, and it kind of sinks in your mind. Another thing that sinks in my mind that I can't believe that he said he's very often fearful when he speak and talk to people, but then his testimonies, one after another, stories after stories. He walked right into a group of gangs and kind of talked to them and preached Jesus to them. All of this is the power of God that gave him the boldness. And we're so happy to have him here with us today. And I don't want to linger on and just pass it on. Thank you again for coming.
Well, good morning. We are blessed that, you know, this is my hometown. San Diego is where I was saved. I was saved in Santee, California, and the Lord did a radical work in my life. And we were working, you know, with many high schools and then the college, you know, in the early days with Miles McPherson. And then the Lord allowed me to start a church there in East San Diego, which is Santee. And the Lord always gave me favor. You know, I could go out to the highways and byways and just share the gospel, and people would get saved. And then we'd bring them back home and disciple them. And then it just grew, and we started a church. And then I realized I don't belong in the four walls of a church. So I went into the mission field. My wife and I, we sold everything we had, and we went to India, and then over to Nepal, and then we started working in different places in Africa, simply because of the weather. You have the monsoon season there in India and Nepal, and if you go to Africa, it's perfect weather. So we started doing that routine. We'd go 3 to 4 months in each location, and we started making a routine of it. for the last 12 years. So God has been faithful for towards us. And during the pandemic, we were in India. We were stuck in India. And of course, the USA came and rescued us. And so we're very patriotic, to say the least. And God rescued us and brought us home. And then there was a church that had partnered with us for the last 7-8 years in Santa Rosa, which is an hour north of San Francisco. And they said, what are you guys doing? And it was right in the beginning of the pandemic. And we said, well, we're not doing anything. And they said, well, come over here and we have some work for you. And because they stayed open during the pandemic, so they were the rebellious ones. And so, but it was awesome. God opened doors for us. They put me in charge of the young adults from 18 to 29. And we started out with 8 young adults on the average. Of course, God brought the increase. And to this day, we have 70 that have come regularly every Thursday. And it's continually growing. And that's just God's grace. And every ministry we get into, God just pours out favor upon us and it grows and we're able to do all kinds of things. So, but I'm a mission pastor there and I get to go all over the world still. And so during the pandemic, I was mostly going to South America, Mexico, Peru, and areas like that. But now that the doors are opening up again, we're heading back out to the different parts of the world. In October, we go to Nepal. So if you'd keep us in prayer, that would be wonderful. Pastor Lam asked me to come and share about evangelism. It was really nice because he set forth the titles, which I'm horrible at making it up, you know. And so he gave me the titles and, you know, We Are All Missionaries was the first night. And how do we know that? Simply because of what Jesus did on the cross after his death, burial, and resurrection. He gave us the verse there in Matthew 28, and let's read that. I think we are, and I'll come back to this screen in a minute, but this is the Great Commission. The Great Commission says this, then Jesus said to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. And so he commands us to do this, and so this is where we have that phrase, we're all missionaries. Because Jesus, it's birthed from this verse here, because Jesus said it. He gave us a command. Now, you have to understand that in the very principle or the foundation of every Christian, we're to make disciples. And how do you do that? You preach the gospel. So we all share the gospel. But within that, you know, foundation, there are those that go above that that have specific callings. Like an evangelist or an apostle. And apostles, you know, we don't have any apostles like that in the Bible, in the New Testament, who set forth doctrines, but we still have apostles that go forth and start new works. And so I would never call myself an apostle, but that's what I do. I go out and start new works all over the world. I'm just not a title guy. So, you know, but the calling is still there to set forth new works. And so God gives you certain gifts, certain abilities above just the normal calling that he's given to everyone to share the gospel. The word mission means that you have an important assignment. Everyone was given an assignment, a mission to make disciples. The only way to do that, of course, is to share the good news with everyone. The go that Jesus is referring to is for some to go across the ocean, no doubt. You know, I've always had that calling in my heart. It's a special calling that the Lord's given me to go anywhere and share the gospel. I'm a normal human being. I'm scared to death. I get on the plane, my heart is pumping, and you know, and I get out and I want to share with somebody. I'm afraid, but I rely on the power of the Holy Spirit. And when the power of the Holy Spirit comes upon me, there's a boldness that comes in, and then I'm able to share. And I just want to assure you that God's going to do that for you as well. Yeah, you can be as afraid as you want, but the Holy Spirit's going to give you boldness, and he's going to allow you to speak out that word. By the way, I see a lot of young high schoolers here. Welcome. You know, that's awesome to see you guys all here. I don't know if you know this, but Ray Bentley, he went on to be with the Lord, but he started Maranatha Church. Do you know in high school, he passed out his first track to a football player? And he was fearful, and this is high school. This is when he was a kid, And he passed out his first track to the football player, big guy, and he thought that football player was going to hit him, you know. And he's like, "Can you just read this?" And the guy goes, "What is it?" And he grabs it out of his hand, and it was the four laws. I have some of that up there, and they're free to take the spiritual tracks there that we have there. And so Ray Bentley turned away and walked off, and this guy began to read it, and tears began to flow through his eyes there, from his eyes, I should say. And at the end, it shows you how to give your life to Jesus. He did, and he invited many of the football players, and that started Ray Bentley's church, by the way. Hundreds and hundreds of high schoolers started getting saved. Of course, the college, and then you guys know Maranatha there was an amazing church, but it started with a young man who had just a calling from the Lord, just to hand a track, just a simple track. I pray that God would do that for some of you. Remember that David was just a young boy when God anointed him. Samuel, the Bible says that the words of Samuel never touched the ground. In other words, his word would always go in the throne room of grace. He was just a young guy called by God. Mary, a young girl, 14, when God called her to bring forth the Son of God in her womb. So very young. So I just want to let you guys know God has a great plan for you if you're willing. I hope that this message would inspire you this morning. The Great Commission, it's for everybody. You know, I think that, the mission field for others is not to go to across the ocean, but your mission field is here, to your neighbor, to your friends, your schoolmate, someone you work with. It means being a disciple maker as you go about your life. You know, I shared with you guys the last couple of days that recently I've been going to McDonald's and, you know, three times a week, and that's why I'm getting wider. And so that's a good way of saying I'm getting fatter. And anyways, that's a polite way. But anyway, that, you know, I go there, but I, you know, the first person that greets me takes my money. Hi, how are you? Good morning. The second person gives me food. Hi, how are you? This, you know, are you having a great day? And then by the fourth time I'm there, I'm handing them an invite card. Hey, because they're young adults. I'm like, hey, come to Young Adults on Thursday night. Really? Where is it? And we have this conversation. It's being a disciple maker here at home, wherever I can. We meet people all over the world. I mean, all over our lives, all over in the sense of in the stores, at the gas station, at work. And we're to make disciple maker in our lives. So let's take advantage of that and hand out an invitation card or even a simple tract. So your mission is right out that door. Amen. You know, a lot of us overlook that because we in America, you have been trained to hide. To hide, don't stir any waves. Don't stare at anybody's faces anymore. Don't smile at anybody because they might ask you for something. So we've been really trained not to love our neighbors. And God wants to change that in us, so we have to move out into the arena of faith. So this morning, I'd like to look at Exodus chapter 3. And the topic this morning is how do we live as missionaries in our environment now? And so I like to look through the life of Moses. Moses was a pretty incredible guy, when you think about his life. He was born to a family who belonged to the Levites there in a time when they were killing all the male children. And of course, he survived. They put him in a little ark, a little boat, a little basket, and they put it in the water. It ended up in Pharaoh's daughter's hands, and she fell in love with the little baby and said, I'm going to take this child as my own. And so Moses, growing up for 40 years, remember this, 40 years he's grown up under the Egyptian kingdom. He has learned all the arts, right? All the skills that the Egyptians have taught and learned for, you know, thousands of years there. He was learning all that. He was learning all the literature. He learned martial arts. He was a commander in in the Egyptian army. There's stories about him being a very powerful leader, a commander in victories. Really, he was raised to hold the scepter one day. One day he might have been the Pharaoh. And so for 40 years, he was trained to be God willing, the Pharaoh. And then you know the story. He ended up seeing an Egyptian beating up on an Israelite, and so he went there and took the Egyptian's life. And of course, that's a capital crime. And so Moses had to run for his life, and so he ran out to the wilderness, and there he was for 40 years. Can you imagine that? 40 years. 40 years taking care of sheep. He had a stick that he developed to have it be a staff. That stick would be with him for 40 years. He knew it well, and he took care of sheep. Can you imagine that? 40 years. Bah. Come on, sheep. Get to the water. Bah. 40 years, day in and day out. And we drop into this story because it's a magnificent story, and it's going to teach us a lot about missions in our own lives. It says this here in verse 1 of Exodus 3, and it's up on the screen there. It says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flames of fire from within the bush. And Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. That's the first strange thing, why the bush doesn't burn up. The second strange thing is the bush is going to talk to him. It says there, when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from the bush, within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. To me, it's comedy, you know, that he's talking to a bush out in the desert, you know, that he loses mind, mental illness. But here he is. God is going to do something spectacular in his life. And I want to just jump out there and say this, guys. God wants to do something amazing in your life, if you're willing. And so it says here in verse 4, do not come any closer. And let me go to the next slide here. It says, do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandal, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. And so here we see God declaring to Moses who he is. He says, I'm the God of your forefathers. I am holy. In Christian theology, the word holy has two meanings. The holiness of God refers to the unparalleled majesty of his incomparable being and his blameless, faultless, unblemished moral purity. God is holy. In him, there is not even the faintest trace of evil. He's impeccably pure, holy without fault, and uncompromisingly just. God cannot lie. He cannot make wrong decision. He is blameless, timeless, and sinless. So when he sees God and he understands a little bit of this theology, he falls on his face and he says, I can't even look at God. And this is such an amazing story here. It goes on to say in verse 7, then the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. And I'm concerned about their suffering. I love that the Lord is concerned about the people of Israel. He hears their crying. He sees their suffering. And so he's going to do something about this. And this reminds me of the New Testament, that God says the same thing regarding the world. Jesus in Luke 4, chapter 4, verse 18, 19 says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to proclaim the good news. Give the good news to the poor in spirit. To set those who've been in captivity free. To bring sight to the blind. To set people who've been oppressed. In our time and where we live today, it's a hopeless people group. People committing suicide, people taking medication, people taking drugs and alcohol, wanting to die. They're hopeless. But we have a message. of Jesus Christ. We have the message of hope. We have the message of eternity. We have the great message that everybody's looking for. Everybody's looking for happiness, but that's of the emotion. You can get that by buying things, doing things. But we can give joy, which is a million times better than happiness. It's the very thing that we're looking for in life. Jesus says, I can give that to you. God is looking at all the human race and saying, they are miserable and they need help. In verse 8, it says, so I have come down to rescue them from the land of Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land and a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelite has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So we see, even in our time, how the devil and this world is oppressing people. And God has come to set us free. God, throughout the scripture, loves the human race. I think about when God sent Jonah to Nineveh, a people group that was not of his own, a really despised people group from Jonah's perspective. And yet Jonah went to Nineveh and started one of the greatest revivals in the history of the Old Testament. Said all the people in Nineveh, that great capital of the Assyrians, turned to God, that whole generation there. That's an amazing story. I think of Paul the Apostle, who walked around modern-day Turkey and then over into Europe, and it said that the Bible says this about him, that he changed the world right side up. How? By pointing him to Jesus. Moses is going to point him to God. Today, you are one of the messengers of God. You're to bring the good news to the hurting people who are brokenhearted, controlled by substance abuse, and so on. God has given you guys, all of us, the task of doing that. And so it goes on to say in verse 10, so now God, it says, now go, and I love that because this is God speaking to Moses, now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people of Israelite out of Egypt. Same principle for us. Jesus said, go and therefore make disciples. You see, what he's saying to Moses, he's saying, I have an assignment for you, Moses. And your assignment, your mission, is to set the Egyptians free. And Jesus has said the same thing for us. I've been giving you an assignment to go to the world and set them free. Give them life, give them hope, give them joy that's inexpressible. And that's the great message we have. No one else has that. No one can heal the brokenhearted like we can. No one can set the captives free like we can. Jesus is the one. So now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, now it's interesting because in this chapter that we're going to read, chapter 3 and then into chapter 4, there are three questions, two from Moses and one from God. And here's the first question that Moses will ask in verse 11. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Now, remember that he knew that he was called to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. So he tried that and he failed miserably. And now he'd been in the desert for 40 years, and now he has a pretty good perspective of who he is. And he says, who am I? I'm nobody. I failed in my first mission attempt. I'm useless. I have this stick in my hand, and I use it to watch over the sheep, you know, and to fight off the wolves, but it has no effect to the world. I wonder if Moses, in those 40 years, ever thought about the Israelites in Egypt. I wonder if he ever thought, man, they're oppressed. How am I going to set them free? How can I go back? I wonder if he ever thought about that. I don't know. We don't know. Here's the first question. Who am I? You know, he's just saying, I'm a nobody. I have no power. I have no authority. we look at this season in his life where he failed in the 40 years he thought he was somebody, and there in Egypt, training to be the next Pharaoh. Now 40 years in the desert, and he says, I'm nobody. And God says, good, because I like working with nobodies. I love that. He, you know, when you think of Moses' ability, he understands, I'm useless now. I want you to know that God's timing is perfect, always, never early, never late. The Lord says to Moses, go, I'm sending you to set my people free. It says there, you know, so now go, I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people out of the Israelites out of Egypt. And Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelite out of Egypt? And so it's perfect. He's just laying the truth out that's in his heart. I'm nobody. So in verse 12, it says this, and God said, I will be with you. And this will be a sign to you that it is I who has sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on the mountain, on this mountain. And Moses said to God, suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask, what is his name? Then what shall I tell them? Now, this is the second question that Moses will ask. He'll say, hey, if they don't believe me and they say, hey, who's sending you? He says, God, to God, who should I tell them sent me? The second question. And I love the response, because God is going to really just open his eyes up. And God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say to the Israelite, the Lord. I am refers to I've always been. I am all things presently. I will always be that forever. The I am is the ultimate statement of self-sufficiency, self-existence, and immediate presence. God's existence is not contingent upon anyone else. His plans are not contingent upon any circumstance. He promised that he will be what he will be. That is, he will be the eternally constant God. He stands ever present and unchangeable, completely sufficient in himself to do what he wills to do and to accomplish what he wills to accomplish. In other words, God will be everything to you. He's the great I am. He's your comforter. He's your healer. I love all those titles he declares in the scriptures about who he is. I will be everything to you. I think that, you know, here in this second question that Moses asked, God's saying, Moses, I'm God, and I'm the great I am, and I can do anything. And I think we need to learn that lesson, my friends. We need to learn that over and over and over, that he's God and he can do anything. And so let us move over to chapter 4 of Exodus here, because here's the third question. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said, what is it that's in your hand? A staff, he replied, a stick. I love that, you know, because here he is, he's just being honest, and he says to God, all I have is a staff, a stick in my hand. That stick to Moses reminds him of his past. He didn't have a staff when he was in Egypt to walk around with. It was given to him when he had to take care of sheep. He probably found an amazing stick, had a knot in there where he can lean on it, you know. He built it so that when he walked, he can walk, and he can grab it in a certain way to defend himself. So he knew that stick in and out. He knew it well. But it reminded him of his failures. It reminded him of his past. And so when God says to him, what is that in your hand? He goes, it's my stick. It's my past. And God's going to say to Moses, Moses, it's your stick, but with me, the great I am, it's just not going to be a normal stick. I'm going to use it for my glory. Now, if you remember the story of Moses carrying the staff, remember the first thing that he's tested with, God says, throw it on the ground. And remember, it turns into that serpent. And remember when Moses takes it to the magicians there in Egypt and he throws it down and it turns into a staff, and the magician says, we can do it. And they throw their staff down and they became a snake. But Moses' snake ate their snakes. The power of God. That staff that Moses remembers his weaknesses, his failures. Now when he touches the Nile, it turns into blood. The staff that he takes and he waves it across the air, it turns to lice, gnats. And even the magician said, that's none other than the fingers of God. You see, when Moses is asked that question, what is it is in your hand? You have to think about those two questions previously. The first question was, I'm sending you. And he says, who am I? I'm nothing. I'm useless. And God says, and then Moses asked the second question. He says, I'm the great I am. And the first part, when God says, what is in your hand? He's thinking about his failures. But now God is saying, what is it in my hand? Because now it becomes the staff of God in your hand. And he'll do the greatest miracles with that staff. He will, raise it up into the air as the Red Sea splits. Remember that? The Jordan there opens up as well. The Red Sea opens up and they walk through. They see the military of Egypt defeated. I think of If Moses never, ever trusted God, all those experiences that we see with his staff would have never happened. The title of my sermon this morning is this: what is in your hand? What is in your hand? You see, because we can come with all our failures and we can say, God, we're useless, and God's going to say, I'm the great I am. And he's going to ask you, what is in your hand? I think of Gideon. Remember when Gideon, he was the weakling out of the bunch. He's saying, I'm a nobody. And God says, blow their trumpet and watch 300 men be victorious over a major military. Blow the trumpet. Take the vases and break them. What's in your hand? When King David was asked to defeat Goliath, what did he have? A slingshot. What's in your hand? What's in your hand? When Samson was defeating the Philistine, what was in his hand? The jawbone of a donkey. What is in your hand? God has placed you strategically here in San Diego for a reason, because you have something in his in your hand that he can use, and all he's asking is, what is in your hand? God wants to do something marvelous through your life. And the question this morning is, what is in your hand? Bring all your failures, bring all your tears, bring all your wanderings, and lay it at the feet of Jesus and say, here I am, God. Use me. Use what's in my hand. You know what was in my hand? Availability. I'm available, God. I'm available. Use me as you seem fit. And because I was available, God said, I'm going to use you. He's taken me all over the world. I've been all over. China, tons of places in Africa. Tanzania, Kenya. There's so many places. All over Asia, preaching the gospel, watching thousands of people come get saved. Setting up Bible colleges, church plants, so many church plants everywhere. And I have nothing to boast about other than Jesus Christ and him crucified. My item that I had in my hand was time, availability. What do you have in your hand? You have finances? Beautiful. If you have time? Beautiful. Are you a sign holder? I was talking to Alan. Alan's like, I can hold a sign in the corner and direct people here to church. And I'm like, what is in your hand, Alan? Amen. What is in your hand? Ray Bentley used a track that was in his hand to hand to a football player. What is it in your hand, high schoolers? God can use you right where you're at and transform the world if you are ready to allow it. This morning I close with that question. What is in your hand? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this time. Thank you for your word. We ask that by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would penetrate our hearts and draw us near to you. Help us to be fishers of men as you've given us that great command. Thank you for this time in Jesus' name. Amen.
What a great privilege it is to have Pastor Juan speaking the truth to us and inviting us to be in God's kingdom, to do his great works. It's all of our responsibility as Christian, as the saved and his children. So let us stand. We're going to conclude actually our conference with a song. As we sing the song, may your heart be convicted, and that you see the urgency that the gospel needs to reach the end of the earth. But it starts here itself as well.
You may be seated. And it's time to pray for our offering. As God's children, the scripture is very clear and instructing us to honor him with our tithes and offering. In Proverbs 3, 9 to 10, it says, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. Then your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will be bursting with wine. And the Lord is great, and he's instructing us in a way that we do not focus our life on material things, but rather on things above, things that was treasure would never be destroyed in heaven. If you desire to offer, there's a box out there in the middle, the brown thing, you know, don't knock over it. You can put your check in there. You can also do it online or by mail or by bank bill pay. So now let's pray. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you have given us a wonderful message, what is in our hands. And we just wanted to thank you, Lord, that you have given us all these blessings. We are lacking nothing, Lord. And thank you that we would be able to honor you with our first fruits of our wealth. So our focus is on you and not on the material things. And Father, now accept our tithes and offering as in worship to you, God, and multiply what's given for the growth of the kingdom. In our Lord Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so welcome everyone. Some of you are new here. I encourage you to contact the people with the tag, the welcoming team. They'll be more than happy to talk to you and get some of the information and keep in contact with you. We'll welcome you and hope you also will be able to join us again next week. And we welcome the youth here, young people. So grateful that God would be able to allow we all worship together, young and old, as a family. So there's some announcement in here. I hope I didn't forget anything. There's an on button. Oh yeah. Good. Thank you. Okay, there you go. So from the youth ministry, so thankful that we have William teaching the apologetic class for the Sunday school. Starting October 16, there will be a new Sunday school. I believe it's taught by Pastor Tim. So any more information, please talk to Pastor Tim. I believe it is an exciting class, talking about learning different characteristics of people. More so the characteristics itself that will actually shape the world and change people. We are so grateful to have Melody doing a great job for the young children. Any questions on the ministry? And it's amazing if you look at our youth and look at our children. I mean, it's like big group of people. They are inviting their friends, and it's a big growth over there. Just keep in mind, when you read this announcement, pray for them. Pray for their spiritual health. Pray for their growth before they even go to college or go to work. It's so essential to learn God's truth and have their foundation established before they even go out to the world. Melody's group is calling graders to participate in next coming Friday evening, 7:30. That will be a fun time of fellowship. And I believe that's for the sixth grader. And then also the GTF, which is the young children group, has a Zoom meeting this afternoon at 2 o'clock, if your parents don't miss it. Any information, any question, any concerns you have, feel free to join that. It's gonna be from 2 o'clock to 3 p.m. and there will be a 15 minutes of prayer. So I encourage parents to participate. Mandarin group is in need for choir members. If you can, you're bilingual, you can speak Mandarin, by all means, join them. And they also need a pianist. And I already gone over through the, and again, thank you, Pastor Bond, you know, for coming to us. And it's a profound message today about what's in our hand, you know, and we all grow up with different skill set, different gifts, and God is going to use it mightily if we're willing to follow. And such an encouraging message. And one thing about Pastor Bond, he's not only a fisher's man, he's really a fisher's. He likes to go fishing, like deep sea fishing. If you happen to be with him, Point Loma out there, deep sea fishing, definitely he'll be a good company. All right. So next, I think we have a coffee after this, you know, 10:15 starting. Half an hour, then there will be Sunday school. You're encouraged to enjoy some refreshment and some healthy snacks like donuts, pastries, you know. And young people, I encourage you to join us as well. The room is a little bit small. We all seem to congregate right around the coffee machine, so no, seems like no one can get the coffee there. So once you get your coffee, just split and, you know, move away from it, and then if it's getting too loud, you're welcome to be outdoor as well. Sunday school, we're resuming Sunday school for the spiritual gifts taught by Sam today at 10:45. And then we'll continue the spiritual gifts next week. For those who have already attended, I encourage you to continue to join us. And after these two Sundays, the class for Mystique on interpreting the Bible will resume with Pastor Tony. Yeah. Okay, so that will be it. Just remind everybody to exit this door. If you happen to try to break through that back door, there will be ushers back there, and they will not arrest you or pin you down, but they will kind you, direct you to come to the front and go through this door. And that's all for safety reasons. And okay, all right, that will be it for the announcement. Thank you.
Let us stand for a time of doxology, and after that, I'd like to invite Bond, Pastor Bond, to give our benediction. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God.
Father, we come before you with thanksgiving in our hearts, and Lord, we thank you for the great commission that you've given to us, Lord, and we want to walk out in faith, Lord. So I pray by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would pour your Spirit afresh upon every single believer here, Lord. that you would speak to them, Lord, about traveling with you, Lord, about using what's in their hand. And so, Lord, will you have your work with us, Lord? Draw us near to you that we might bring you glory. Thank you for this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, in the back, I know you can't go there now, but later on I have tracts you can take for free. And then my prayer cards back there. Will you take one and pray for me? And together we'll impact the world for Jesus, all right? God bless you. You're dismissed.
Have a good week.